Proceed further. I want to welcome Mr. M.M. Yusuf, retired General Manager, Reserve Bank of India, who is also serving President of Nizam NGO. I also welcome Mr. M. Venkateswarulu, who is the President of Telangana Chamber of Commerce and Industry, to the program. Thank you, sir. Thank you for coming. We all are aware the topic of today's talk is Islam and humanity. And as I know, all of you have understood the importance of the topic also. Nowadays, when the world or the populist media, which is showing abuses and all kinds of hatred towards Islam, considering Islam or relating it to all kinds of violence happening around the a sensible discussion on how Islam preaches humanity. And who else can be a better person than Sheikh Muhammad bin Yahya al-Husayni al-Nainawi, who is a scholar of Islam from Syria, and who is an imam of Al-Madinah Masjid and an institute in Atlanta, Georgia, United States of America. I request Dr. Sayyid Ali Mashraf Jaisi Sahab, who is Associate Professor, Department of Arabic, Maulana Azad National Urdu University, and the President of Ahle Sunnah Volunteers Association, which is conducting this program, to come and introduce the guests to all of us. Ali Mashraf Jaisi Sahab.
الحمد لله الذي بنعمته تتم الصالحات وبفضله تتحقق الغايات والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ومولانا وحبيبنا وقائدنا وإمامنا ومرشدنا وقرة أعيننا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن سار على دربه ونسج على منواله الى يوم الدين. حضرت گرامی شیخ جامع نظام تشریف لا رہے ہیں، آپ ان کا استقبال کیجیے، ان سے گزارش ہے حضرت آج کے اس پروگرام کی صدارت فرمائیں گے.
نعرے تکبیر، نعرے رسالت.
خطبہ مسنونہ کے بعد سب سے پہلے میں اپنی اعزازیہ مفتی اعظم دکن حضرت علامہ مولانا مفتی محمد خلیل احمد صاحب فرمائیں گے، اور انہی کی صدارت میں یہ پروگرام جو ہے انشاءاللہ تبارک و تعالی پائے تکمیل کو پہنچے گا. فضیلت الداعیہ الی اللہ علی علم و بصیرہ، الشیخ محمد بن یحییٰ بن محمد بن سعید بن علی النینوی حفظہ اللہ، شینشین پر تشریف رکھنے والے عمائدین، ڈگنیٹریز، اہل سنہ والنٹیئر ایسوسیشن کے سرگرم اور پرجوش رضاکار حضرات، سامعین کرام، جس وقت سے آج ہم اور ہماری دنیا گزر رہی ہے اور جن حالات سے ہم اور ہماری یہ دنیا گزر رہی ہے، اس میں ایسے پروگرام کی ضرورت پہلے سے بہت زیادہ ہو گئی ہے. آپ سب جانتے ہیں کہ کمیونسٹ جو نظام تھا، اس کے ڈاؤن فال کے بعد ہماری یہ دنیا سنگل پولر ہو گئی، اور کچھ ایسی صورتحال بنی جس سے بظاہر ایسا لگا کہ کچھ ویسٹرن فورسز جو ہے، ویسٹرن طاقتیں جو ہے، وہ اس سنگل پولر دنیا میں एक अलग किस्म का डोमिनेशन चाहती है। चुनाचे उसका पूरी दुनिया में उसका रद्द अमल हुआ, उसका रिएक्शन हुआ। आलमी इस्लाम में वो रिएक्शन कुछ ज्यादा ही शदीद था। आलमी इस्लाम में पहले ही से कुछ शिद्दत पसंद एलिमेंट्स और आइडियोलॉजीज जो है वो पनप रही थी। उन्हें ये डिस्क्रिमिनेशन जो है, ये वेस्टर्न डिस्क्रिमिनेशन और वेस्टर्न डोमिनेशन जो है वो उनके लिए बहाना हो गया। और चुनांचे इस्लामिक वर्ल्ड में वो जो आइडियोलॉजिकल एक्सट्रीमिज्म था उसको फलने फूलने का मौका मिला। और मुझे कहने दीजिए कि एक्चुअली ये दोनों फोर्सेस, वेस्ट की कॉलोनियल फोर्सेस और ईस्ट का एक्सट्रीमिज्म जो था, आइडियोलॉजिकल एक्सट्रीमिज्म जो बाद में कन्वर्ट होकर जो है वो पॉलिटिकल एक्सट्रीमिज्म बन गया, वो ये दोनों फोर्सेस जो है वो एक दूसरे के लिए कॉम्प्लीमेंट जैसी बनती हुई नजर आई। इन्होंने वेस्ट को एक्सक्यूज दिया कि वो ज्यादा से ज्यादा इंटरफेरेंस करे और आलम इस्लाम में, इस्लामिक वर्ल्ड में वेस्टर्न इंटरफेरेंस जो है था उसने इन एक्सट्रीमिस्ट फोर्सेस को जो है और लिजिटिमेसी दी, उन्हें और जो है उनके मौकफ को जो है वो मजबूत किया। हमें भूलना नहीं चाहिए कि अभी कुछ दिन पहले सैमुअल हंटिंगटन की किताब जो है द न्यू वर्ल्ड ऑर्डर जो है, एंट्री मेकिंग ऑफ न्यू वर्ल्ड ऑर्डर द क्लैश ऑफ सिविलाइजेशन, ये किताब आई और इसको बड़ी बिजी राइट मिली। जबकि दुनिया जानती है कि सिविलाइजेशन का क्लैश ये बिल्कुल एक फर्जी बेअसल और बेबुनियाद बात है। यूनिपोलर दुनिया में ग्लोबलाइजेशन जो है इसने भी जो है अपना एक स्पेशल जो है रोल अदा किया। और ग्लोबलाइजेशन जो है ये अच्छी चीज है, ये पूरी दुनिया सबसे पहले ग्लोबलाइजेशन का अगर एक्चुअल कंसेप्ट था वो नबी करीम सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम ने पेश किया जब आपने फरमाया, जब कुरान आया उसकी पहली सूरत की पहली आयत आई अल्हम्दुलिल्लाह रब्बिल आलमीन, अल्लाह के लिए तारीफ है जो कि रब है, पालनहार है सारे आलम, यही ग्लोबलाइजेशन था, ये आइडियोलॉजिकल ग्लोबलाइजेशन था। नबी करीम सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम फरमाते हैं कि अल खल्कु अयानुल्लाह, हमारे कुछ डिग्नेटरीज हैं वो जो जानते होंगे वसुधैव कुटुंबकम का कांसेप्ट उन्होंने सुना होगा, अल खल्कु अयानुल्लाह में वही बात कही कि ये सारी कायनात जो है, ये सारी यूनिवर्स जो है, ये अल्लाह का कुंबा, समस्त संसार और सृष्टि जो है ये अल्लाह का परिवार है। وَحَبُّكُمْ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَحْسَنُهُمْ مِنْ خَلْقِهِ، اور اللہ کے رسول پروفیٹ حضرت محمد صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم فرماتے ہیں کہ اللہ کے نزدیک سب سے زیادہ محبوب وہ ہے جو اس کے بندوں کے لیے سب سے زیادہ اچھا کرنے والا ہے۔ اگر آپ سمپلی آپ دیکھیں کہ اللہ رب العالمین یعنی توحید کا جو کانسیپٹ ہے اسلام میں، یونٹی آف گاڈ جو ہے وہ ہمیں یونٹی آف ہیومینٹی کی طرف جو ہے لیڈ کرتی ہے कि जब खुदा एक है, एक ही बनाने वाला है, एक ही पालने वाला है, एक ही पैदा करने वाला है, एक ही जो है वो क्रिएटर नरेशर है, तो जाहिर सी बात है कि हम सब उसके रिश्ते से एक, एक बनाने वाला जो है वो बनने वाले भी एक, बनने वाले भी एक हुए। तो ये यहां तक ग्लोबलाइजेशन बहुत अच्छा था, लेकिन वेस्टर्न डोमिनेशन ने के सहारे उनका कल्चर, उनकी तहजीब, उनका तरीका जो है वो भी जो है वो हावी होने लगा। तो वो जो एक्सट्रीमिस्ट, ये उम्र हमारे स्टेजों से ये बात नहीं कही जाती मगर अब बेहद जरूरत है कि मर्ज को छुपाने के बजाय उसका ऐलान किया जाए, प्रॉब्लम को जो है उसको छुपाने के बजाय उसको बताया जाए। तो ये चीजें आई, क्लैश ऑफ सिविलाइजेशन की थ्योरी आई और हेनरी किसिंजर जो 67 में जो है यूएस के जो है फॉरेन सेक्रेटरी थे, उन्होंने कहा कि ये किताब जो है सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर के बाद जो है सबसे अच्छी किताब। उसके बाद आप जानते हैं बर्नार्ड लीव्स के पेपर्स आए, प्रिंस ऑफ डेथ ऑफ ए प्रिंसेस जो है फिल्म आई, उसके बाद इंटरनेट के जरिए बेशुमार ऐसे भड़काऊ इफ्तिज़ाज़ी और जो है ऐसे पेपर मकाला किताबें आई जिसने आलमी इस्लाम में पनप रहे जो है शिद्दत पसंदी के रुझानात को तकवीत दी। मीडिया ने भी जो थोड़े से एक्सट्रीमिस्ट लोग थे उनको ज्यादा तवज्जो दी और जो मुसलमानों का पीसफुल मास था उसको बिल्कुल निग्लेक्ट कर दिया। मीडिया चाहती थी कि उसकी थी अपने की बुनियाद पर मीडिया की टीआरपी बढ़ी कि नहीं बढ़ी, अलबत्ता जो एक्सट्रीमिस्ट एलिमेंट थे उनकी पॉपुलरिटी में बेशुमार इजाफा हुआ। जिन एक्सट्रीमिस्ट को कोई नहीं जानता था उनको हमारी मीडिया ने बता दिया कि फला फला गिरो फला फला लोग जो है एक्सट्रीमिस्ट है। तो गोया हमारी मीडिया ने अमन पसंद अमन और अमन पसंदों का प्रचार करने के बजाय उसने एक्सट्रीमिस्ट और एक्सट्रीमिज्म का जो है वो प्रचार किया। पूरे मराको से लेकर मलेशिया, ये बदकिस्मती है आलम इस्लाम की कि ज्यादातर जो हुकूमतें चल रही हैं वो सब जो है अनडेमोक्रेटिक हुकूमतें, वहां शहंशाही है, वहां खानदानी विरासत है, वहां डिक्टेटरशिप है, वहां जो है 99.99% वोट पाने वाले जो है वो प्रेसिडेंट्स हैं मगर डेमोक्रेसी का कहीं पता नहीं है। तो इन रूलर्स ने अपने सर्वाइवल के लिए एक्सट्रीमिस्ट एलिमेंट का इस्तेमाल किया, एक्सट्रीमिस्ट एलिमेंट का इस्तेमाल किया। हम सब जानते हैं कि आज जो अमेरिका को सबसे ज्यादा मतलूब है 20 साल पहले वही सबसे ज्यादा महबूब थे, आज जो सबसे ज्यादा वांटेड है 20 साल 25 साल पहले वही सबसे ज्यादा क्लोज थे। शायद दुनिया ने नहीं जाना होगा, हमने वेस्टर्न मीडिया के जरिए अफगानिस्तान और कंधार और सवात और वजीरिस्तान को हमने जाना, उनके जरिए से जाना। एक एरो ब्रिज था जो रियाद से कंधार को जोड़ता था। तो जो एक्सट्रीमिज्म आइडियोलॉजिकल था, लोगों के सीने में दफन था, ज्यादा से ज्यादा किताबों में पेपर में था, अमेरिका की मदद से कुछ मुस्लिम मुल्क ने उस एक्सट्रीमिज्म को जो है एक्सपोर्ट किया अफगानिस्तान एक्सपोर्ट किया और वहां से ये पूरी दुनिया में फैल। मैं आपको बताना चाहता हूं कि अभी एक किताब जो है इमाम डॉक्टर अब्दुल अजीज इमाम फजल है जो इजिप्ट के जेल में है, प्रिजन में है, वहां प्रिजन से उन्होंने किताब लिखी जिसका नाम है अतबरिया। और ये वो शख्सियत है जो एक जमाने में मुफ्ती मुजाहिदीन फिल आलम के नाम से जाने जाते थे, ग्रेट ग्रैंड मुफ्ती ऑफ ऑल जिहादिस्ट इन द यूनिवर्स, ये टाइटल था। मगर उन्हें एक दिन अल्लाह ने अकल दी, उन्होंने समझा कि हम एक अंधेरी कोठरी की तरफ जा रहे हैं, वो वापिस आए, सरेंडर हुए और जेल चले गए। उन्होंने अपनी किताब में, ये किताब उनकी अशरकुल अवसत, ये सऊदी जर्नल है जिसमें 18 दिसंबर 2008 से लेकर 30 दिसंबर 2008 तक में ये किताब पूरी पब्लिश हुई है। इस किताब में डॉक्टर अब्दुल अजीज फजल ने कहा इन हकीका अयनमा हलत अलकायदा हलत दिमारु अल मुस्लिमीन, कि जहां जहां अलकायदा गया है वहां वहां मुसलमानों पर तबाही और बर्बादी है। जो वर्ल्ड ट्रेड सेंटर का गिरने से जो धमाका हुआ उसमें लोगों ने आर्म इस्लाम के बारे में तो बड़ा चर्चा किया मगर जो मजलूम इस्लाम था, जो विक्टिम इस्लाम था, उसको न मीडिया ने कवरेज दिया, न वेस्टर्न जो कॉलोनियल फोर्सेस ने उसको न दिया, न हमारे मुल्क की हुकूमतों ने दिया, न आलमी इस्लाम में किसी ने दिया। दोस्तों हम जानते हैं नश्तर पार्क से आप वाकिफ हैं जहां पर मुसलमान जो है वो शिकार हुए। हमारा कहना यह है कि मुसलमान जो है इस एक्सट्रीमिज्म का पहला विक्टिम खुद मुसलमान। आप अफगानिस्तान में देखिए, इराक में देखिए, जो अभी सीरिया में हो रहा है उसको देखिए, अल्जीरिया में, और न जाने कौन कौन सी तंजीम है जो इस्लाम के नाम से है और उनका निशाना अगर कोई चीज है तो सबसे पहले मुसलमान है। तो दरअसल बुनियादी तौर पर ये जो सूरत हाल है दुनिया को जानना चाहिए कि इस्लाम एक अमन पसंद दीन है, एक ऐसा अमन पसंद दीन है, ऐसा दीन है कि नबी करीम सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम कहीं से गुजर रहे थे, कोई शख्स जो है अपनी बकरी का दूध निकाल रहा था तो अल्लाह के रसूल ने फरमाया कि फलान इब्के लिए वाला दिया फइन्हा मिन अबरि दवाब, एक इंसान सारा दूध इस जानवर से नहीं निकाल लेना, इसके बच्चे के लिए भी छोड़ देना, ये बड़ा नेक जानवर। तो जो दीन इस हकीक जानवर के लिए इतना जो है तड़प रखता हो अपने दिल में, वो इंसानों के कपड़े आपसे राजी कैसे हो सकता है, कैसे राजी हो सकता है। हजरत कुफैल दौसी अल्लाह के रसूल सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम के पास आए, सही बुखारी और मुस्लिम ने हदीस को रवायत किया है और कहा या रसूल अल्लाह इन्ना दौसन अबत व असर फदुल्लाह अलैहा, या रसूल अल्लाह दौस वाले जो है ये ऐसे संगदिल हैं, अपने कुफ्र में इस कदर गर्क हैं कि बात भलाई की बात सुनने को नहीं चाहते, आप इनके लिए दुआ कर दीजिए, बद दुआ कर दीजिए, अल्लाह इनको हलाक कर दे, अल्लाह इनको बर्बाद कर दे। حديث شريف معايا فتوجه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم جهه القبله لكن صوت قبله کی طرف ورفع يديه اپنے دست مبارک کو اٹھایا راوی حدیث کہتا ہے فایقن الناس بحلاک دوس لوگوں کو یقین ہو گیا کہ ابھی آپ بدعا کریں گے اور یہ پوری قوم ہلاک ہو جائے گی مگر اللہ کے رسول صلی اللہ تعالی علیہ وسلم کے زبان مبارک سے اللهم اهدی دوس اے اللہ دوست ہدایت عطا فرما انہیں گائیڈ کر انہیں نیکی اور بھلائی کا راستہ دکھا دوستو میں اپنی وقت بہت مختصر ہے میں نے آپ کو بتایا تھا کہ حضرت موسیٰ علیہ السلام نے جب اس بکری کے بچے کے ساتھ نیک سلوک کیا اس کے کانٹے نکالے جس بکری کے بچے نے انہیں دن بھر دوڑایا تھا تو اس کے بعد اللہ تبارک و تعالیٰ نے فرشتوں میں جو ہے مباحث فرماتے ہوئے کہا کہ دیکھو یہ میرا بندہ ہے جو نبوت اور پروفٹ ہڈ کا حقدار ہے اسی کو پروفٹ ہڈ ملنی چاہیے جو اس بکری کے بچے کے ساتھ اتنا اچھا سلوک کرنا چاہتا اور عزیز آنے کے آپ دیکھیں صرف حضرت موسیٰ نہیں ہے ہمارے ایک ٹریڈیشن ہے جس میں آیا ہے کہ سارے انبیاء کرام نے بکری کو چرایا ہے اے کل نبی راج زنما ہر نبی نے بکری کو چرایا ہے آپ جانتے ہیں کہ آخر بکری کو چرانے میں کیا سی فضیلت ہے کون سا حکمت ہے کون سا سیکرٹ ہے کون سا راز ہے کون سی جو ہے وزڈم اس میں پوشیدہ ہے کیوں 124,000 انبیاء کرام کو بکری چرانے کی جو ہے ذمہ داری کیوں دی گئی اس لیے کہ دوستو بکری ایک ایسا جانور ہے کہ جس میں دو خوبیاں ہوتی ہیں ایک تو فزیکلی بے حد ویک ہوتا ہے بہت ہی کمزور جانور ہے اور دوسری بات بے حد ناسمجھ جانور ہے سمجھتا بھی نہیں کچھ ہے کچھ بات بھی قبول کرنے کو تیار نہیں کچھ بھی آپ دنیا کے کسی جانور کو آپ کچھ بھی سکھا دیجیے مگر بکری کو آپ کچھ بھی نہیں سکھا سکتے جو آپ چاہیں گے اس کے خلاف ہی کرے گا اور اس پر یہ ہے کہ کمزور ہے اگر آپ کو بار بار غصہ آئے گا اور اگر زیادہ غصہ آئے گا تو آپ کیا کریں گے اگر آپ نے اس کی پٹائی کی تو بکری سے ہاتھ دھو بیٹھیں گے یہاں تک کہ بعض بزرگان نے جی نے کہا کہ جن لوگوں کو بڑا جو شارٹ ٹمپرز ہیں جو بڑا غصہ جلدی آ جاتا ہے انہیں چاہیے کہ بکری پالیں 40 دن تک بکری رکھیں یا تو بکری ختم ہو جائے گی یا غصہ ختم دونوں اکٹھا نہیں رہ سکتے 40 دن 40 دن تک مجھے اگر پتا ہوتا میں بھی پرانے شہر سے ڈرائیو کر کے آیا اگر مجھے پتا ہوتا میں اس کو پرانے شہر میں ڈرائیو کرنے کو بھی جو ہے نفس خوشی کا ایک ذریعہ بتا سکتا ہوں بلکہ میرے پاس وہ بیٹھے تھے میں نے کہا آج کی خانقاہوں میں مجاہدے کی جو طریقے ہیں ان میں یہ طریقہ بھی ہو سکتا ہے کہ پرانے شہر میں روزانہ آدھے گھنٹے جو ہے آپ کار چلائیے اس سے بھی آپ کا نفس جو ہے بڑا ہی کمزور ہوگا اور آپ کا غصہ اور آپ کا جو ہے غضب جو ہے وہ سرد ہوگا تو دوستو جانور ایسا ہے کہ جو غصہ آپ کو دلائے گا اور آپ اپنا غصہ اس پر نکال بھی نہیں سکتے تو سوائے اس کے کہ آپ اپنے نفس پر قابو پائیں آپ اپنے غصے پر قابو پائیں آپ اپنی جو ہے کوالٹیز جو ہیں ان کو چینج کرنے کی کوشش کریں شاید یہی حکمت ہے کہ انبیاء کرام بھی جو ہے وہ انسانوں کو چرانے ہی والے ہیں انسانوں کے گائیڈنس کے لیے بھیجے گئے ہیں اور انسان بھی ناسمجھ بھی ہے اور کمزور بھی ہے لہذا اللہ تعالیٰ نے اپنے پروفٹ کے ذریعے کو بکری چروا کر جو ہے ٹرین کیا کہ کیسے انسانوں کی ہدایت اور گائیڈنس کا کام کیا جائے یہ صحیح اسلام ہے جو ہمیشہ دوسروں سے محبت کرنے کی بات کرتا ہے آج دلت رائٹ کی بات کی جاتی ہے آج دلت اتھان کے لیے نہ جانے کتنی آرگنائزیشن کتنی چیزیں بنی ہے میں ہندوستان کی تاریخ میں کہتا ہوں میرے سامنے جو پہلی مثال ہے اجمیر شریف میں 800 سال پہلے 800 سے زیادہ سال پہلے ایک دلت حضرت خواجہ غریب نواز رحمت اللہ تعالیٰ علیہ کے پاس آیا اور اس نے کہا کہ فلاں جاگیردار نے میری زمین پر قبضہ کر لیا ہے تو حضرت نے کہا کہ میں دعا کروں گا اس نے کہا صرف دعا سے کام نہیں چلے گا آپ کو سفارش کرنا پڑے گی تو حضرت خواجہ نے کہا یا اجمیر میں تو کوئی ایسے اتھارٹی نہیں ہے جس سے سفارش کرنے کا آپ کام چلے دلت نے کہا کہ آپ کو میرے ساتھ دلی چلنا پڑے سمجھیے سلطان الہند ہیں نائب رسول ہیں اس بقعہ عرض میں اور وہ دلت ان سے کہہ رہا ہے کہ آپ کو چلنا پڑے گا اور دنیا جانتی ہے کہ حضرت خواجہ غریب نواز رحمت اللہ تعالی علیہ نے اس دلت کے لیے اجمیر سے دلی تک کا پیدل سفر کیا میں پوچھنا چاہتا ہوں دلت اتھان کی بات کرنے والے دلت اپلیفٹمنٹ کی بات کرنے والے کہ کوئی ہندوستان کے تاریخ سے سولائزیشن سے کوئی ایسا قصہ جو اس سے بھی پرانا وہ نکال کے نہیں دکھا سکتے یہی بات ہے حضرت خواجہ نظام الدین محبوب الہی فرماتے ہیں اسلام کے ٹرو جو ہے ریپرزنٹیٹیو ہیں فرماتے ہیں کہ عبادت دو طرح کی ہوتی ہے ایک لازم عبادت ہوتی ہے ایک متعدی عبادت ہوتی ہے لازم عبادت وہ ہے جس کا فائدہ صرف کرنے والے کو ملتا ہے جیسے کہ نماز روزہ और हज वगैरह है, और फरमाया एक इबादत जो है वो मुतादी होती है, जिसका करने वाला भी फायदा उठाता है और दूसरे भी उससे फायदा उठाते हैं। फरमाया कि वो मुतादी इबादत जो है खिदमत खल्क है, सर्विस फॉर मैनकाइंड है, कि करने वाले को सवाब मिलता है और उसका फायदा दूसरों तक भी पहुंचता है। तो हजरत गिरामी हजरत ख्वाजा करीम नवाज, हजरत निजामुद्दीन महबूब इलाही, हजरत ख्वाजा बंदा नवाज की सुदराब, ये इस्लाम के हकीकी नुमाइंदे हैं। आप देखें तो इनके कलाम में, इनके कौल में, इनके फेल में, इनके अमल में इंसानियत के लिए मोहब्बत का एक समुंदर आपको ठाठे मारता हुआ मिलेगा। ये कुछ जो रास्ता भूले हुए लोग हैं, जो भटके हुए लोग हैं, ये सही नहीं है। इंशाअल्लाह तबारक व तआला तसव्वुफ की वापसी, तसव्वुफ की तरफ वापसी का अमल शुरू हो चुका है। मैंने आपको पिछले प्रोग्राम में बताया कि अभी जो है एक रिपोर्ट आई है, एक रिपोर्ट जर्नलिस्टिक रिपोर्ट आई है, उसमें कहा गया है कि पिछले 10 सालों में सूफी इस्लाम को सबसे ज्यादा रिप्रेजेंटेशन जो है सैटेलाइट चैनल पर अब मिलना शुरू हुआ है। अभी आज से 10 साल पहले 10% जो है वो सैटेलाइट चैनल पर सूफी इस्लाम का रिप्रेजेंटेशन नहीं होता था, मगर आज वो बढ़कर 70% तक इजिप्ट में पहुंच चुका है। और अल्हम्दुलिल्लाह ये चारों तरफ से जो है खबर आ रही है। और जब हम सूफी इस्लाम की तरफ लौटेंगे, जो हकीकी इस्लाम है जिसमें इंसानियत से हमदर्दी की बात की गई है, जो वसुधैव कुटुंबकम की बात करता है, जो खल्के खुदा की खिदमत की बात करता है, जो अमन राष्ट्र की बात करता है, जो टॉलरेंस की बात करता है, जो कोएग्जिस्टेंस की बात करता है, और इसी एहयाए तसव्वुफ रिवाइवल ऑफ सूफीज्म का एक पार्ट जो है शेख जो है हिंदुस्तान आमद भी है। शेख भी जो है तसव्वुफ के एक बड़े दाई हैं, अमन और सलामती और आशती की दावत देने वाली एक बड़े बड़ा नाम है। आपका ताल्लुक जो है अटलांटा जॉर्जिया यूएसए से है, जहां आप खतीब और इमाम हैं। और दिलचस्प बात यह है कि आपके जद्दे करीब जो है वो इराक में करबला से जो है हिजरत करके जो है हलब शहबा तशरीफ ले गए थे, और वे वही है जो उर्दू मरसियों में, उर्दू नौहों में जो है नैनवा के नाम से जो है हम जानते हैं। बल्कि अगर इसका सही तलफ्फुज़ अगर किया जाए तो उर्दू शायरी से बहुत सारे शेर जो है वो बाहर निकल जाएंगे, बहर से बाहर निकल जाएंगे, क्योंकि नैनवा जो है हम नैनवा के नाम से जानते हैं, वहां से इनका खानदान हजरत इमाम मूसा काजिम के साहबजादे हजरत इमाम मोहम्मद आदिल और उनके साहबजादे हजरत इब्राहिम मुजाब पहले शख्स हैं जिन्होंने नैनवा में जो है वो सुकूनत अख्तियार की। और उसके बाद जो है 33 जनरेशन के बाद आपके जो है चौथे दादा जो है हजरत सैयद शेख सैयद अली नीनवी जो है नीनोई जो है वो नैनवा से जो है हिजरत करके जो है सीरिया शाम चले गए, और वहाँ आपका खानदान रहा। शेख की वही पैदाइश है। शेख की एक बड़ी खूबी है कि आज हमारे ज़माने में जिस पीरियड में हम रह रहे हैं, हदीस की सारी बड़ी सनदें जो है वो दो बड़ी शख्सियतों तक जाकर पहुँचती हैं, सैयद मोहम्मद अलवी अलमालिकी जो है हदीस हरमैन शरीफैन, और शेख अब्दुल्ला बिन सिद्दीक अल-हुमारी। शेख इन दोनों इजाजतों और सनदों के जामे हैं। इसके अलावा भी अरब के तमाम बड़े सूफी उलमा और मशाइख की सनद और इजाजत है। गोया बलद से दीगर ये तमाम अहले अरब के तमाम अहले सुन्नत और जमात के रिप्रेजेंटेटिव हैं, उनके नुमाइंदे हैं, उनके स्पोक्स पर्सन हैं। हम चाहते हैं कि हमारा भारत, हमारा देश जो है जिसकी जो है सुख शांति के लिए हम हमेशा कामना करते हैं, हमेशा अमल करते हैं, हम चाहते हैं वो भी इनकी आवाज़ को सुने। और हमारा मीडिया जो है जो हमेशा छोटे छोटे टेलीविजन के एड्स पर जो है इतना आसमान पर जो है उठा लेता है, शोर करता है, वो इनकी आवाज़ को भी सुने, इनकी आवाज़ को भी तवज्जो दे, जो हकीकी और सही इस्लाम की आवाज़ है। वफ़क़कुमुल्लाह जमीअन व सलाम अलैकुम व रहमतुल्लाहि तआला व बरकातुहू।
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد سيد الأولين والآخرين وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه والتابعين. أما بعد، فالسلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. First of all, I'd like to thank you all for coming out here today. And I, Urdu is not a language that I actually put some time to understand. Now I realize I should have put some time to learn the language. So I was at a disadvantage. But I have to say, though, you know, with a scholarly figure, such and a spiritual figure, such as Sayyid Ali Mashraf, this great sheikh and personality. It was a language that they say, Lughatul Qulub, it was the language of the heart. So I could understand, despite I really don't understand much of Urdu, but I really could understand a little bit, at least the gist of what Sayyidina Sheikh Sayyid Ali Ashraf Hafidhahullah Ta'ala was saying. And I have to say, I'm obviously very impressed, alhamdulillah. And he did half of the job I had to do. I also would like to acknowledge our Sayyidina Sheikh Al-Mufti Muhammad Khalid Ahmad, Sheikh Al-Jami'a Al-Nidamiya, Hafidhahullah Ta'ala wa Ra'ahu wa Ala Maqamahu wa Madrathullah Al-Ali. It is a great honor and a great pleasure and a personal privilege for me to be sitting with these great personalities that are here, and also all the other dignitaries and all of you. And thank you very much for inviting me to speak here today. I always like to start with the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at least for the Sunnah of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith that is sahih, and you all know, إن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And there is an ayah that while Sheikh Sayyid Alim was talking, there is an ayah that came to my mind where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran said, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام الله كان عليكم رقيبا. الآية is known. القرآن الكريم, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes has different variations in the khitab. Some khitab or some address is to يا أيها الناس, O humankind. I'm just not saying O mankind, because some of our sisters may disagree. They say, why you say O mankind, but O womankind? Though by man, we really mean human. But let's just get out of all these things. Let's say O humankind. So we're done with that problem now. O humankind. Ya ayyuhan nas. All of you. Sometimes Allah says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe. Other times the Quran Kareem says, Ya ayyuhan nas, O humanity. Sayyid Ali Mashraf, Sheikh al-Fadhil, has spoken about a theory that is running around, especially lately, that's been driven, obviously, a lot. The clash of civilization, and he spoke about what Samuel P. Huntington talked about. Look, I mean, obviously, there's a couple of theories running around. Obviously, it's not only Samuel Huntington, but you also have Harris. You have also Francis Fukuyama. You have Bernard Lewis. And there's an idea that, all right, to be real and realistically speaking, a dominant culture, and not necessarily militarily dominant, a culture that's advanced technologically, that's advanced academically, that's advanced in medical sciences, that's advanced in many of the sciences of the world today, has a dominating effect. That goes without a doubt. I mean, that goes without any saying. Such culture will always influence other cultures. So, whether it is by design or by consequence of the virtue that it is, either civically, and again, you can put quote-unquote on civic. Obviously, we are in India, and India is one of the greatest civilizations in the world. And it's an old, ancient country with great civilizations and great people. We do live, according, obviously, to Huntington, in a world that is changing rapidly in many ways. Obviously, today, young people, whether you are in Belgium or Bangalore, you pretty much dress the same. Pretty soon, you're probably gonna eat also the same and talk the same. Even the expressions are the same. The gestures, even if there could be cultural gestures, they're becoming the same. Basically, Huntington is saying that the world is becoming a global village, and it is inevitable that cultures will actually diminish little by little, and the whole world will be one thing, and people will be the same thing. That has obviously been impacted because of the economical system worldwide. Today, the world is a huge market, economically speaking, and therefore, obviously, again, every single human being is a potential consumer. Regardless where you are, everyone is carrying iPhones or Samsung or all these things. I mean, this is, it's everywhere. All right? According to Huntington and other, Bernard Lewis and other people who talked about the clash of civilizations, cultures are not going to be as much of an obstacle. What's going to be an obstacle really is religion. Regardless what religion it is, I'm not just talking about, obviously, يعني إن الدين عند الله الإسلام كتاب الله تعالى السنة في سيدنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الإسلام as a faith system. I'm talking about all faith systems, because faith systems as well are an identity. What does that mean? Oftentimes people, and when people say I'm a Muslim, or some others say I'm a Christian, or some say I'm a Hindu, or some say I'm a Sikh, or whatever faith system they belong to, oftentimes this is an identity. More than a set of practiced belief. Lots of people say what they believe, and few believe what they say. An identity thing, this is me, I don't, you know, whether I adhere to the rules of this religion or I don't adhere, it's an identity. I believe in this religion. And obviously I'm not going to go there, but again, religion carries an identity in the sense because it also, there's an element of culture that's always compartmentalized with religion as well, with religious practices, especially with ritual practices of the religion. So therefore you'll see ritualistic differences in religious practices from region to region, from culture to culture, from country to country, etc., etc. And obviously, as Muslims, we go back, the unification factor for us is the Quran and the Sahih of the Sunnah. For us, Al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, for example, that what unifies everyone, we all unify around that, and then obviously you always have, you know, other things that are not necessarily institutionalized as part of the religion, but they're practiced as permissible rituals based on different cultures and different places and different regions. So to the clash of civilization theory, religion becomes a problem. Hence, the rising anti-God or anti-religion sentiment in the world. It's not just Islam. No. There's a diminishing attachment to the faith system, in any faith almost. And if I may take you back, and it's not something that, again, we're all human beings, and I'll talk about that in just a minute. I mean, remember that. All humanity, Islam looks at all humanity as a family. It doesn't matter what your faith system is. I don't care what you worship, I don't care what your religion is. You're one family. Islam believes that our father is Adam and our mother is Hawa. By that default, by that definition, every single human being that walks on this earth, regardless what faith, color, creed, caste, whatever you want, they're your brothers and sisters. That's a fact. What I'm trying to say is, what affects people in part of the world will inevitably affect all of us. What affects a segment of society, let's say here you are in India, this great and beautiful country, and I'm getting to see it, and, you know, I'm seeing all this. Today I was flying from Bangalore to Hyderabad, and I saw all this green stuff and all that. I like that. It's very nice. What affects a segment of society in India will affect the rest of society. And what affects India will affect the rest of the world. That's just a fact. In the old days, 100, 200, 300 years ago, it used to take centuries or decades to get to where you are. Since we live in a global village, today any change in the world takes place instantaneously in another place in the world. To the clash, so that diminished relationship with God, anti-God in a sense, anti-God movement. And again, you see in Europe, same thing happened in Europe. That's the reason I'm saying this. If you go back again to the Catholic Church in Europe and how it was prosperous, and surely it was dominating the whole place, and you all know that. I'm not going to go to the whole history. But then you had the Martin Luther movement, which was a reform to the church, and he put on the door of the church in Europe the 99 things that ought to be there for a reforming of the church, because he saw the faith becoming very rigid, very ritual, rather than spiritual as well. So it's the mechanics of worship and the identity, rather than what is the purpose of worship. What is the purpose of you being a faithful person? The purpose is to make you a better worshiper of your Creator, and a better servant of His creation. In summary, a better human being, or to maximize your potential as a human being. That's what makes you a better Muslim. Anyway, I always say a good Muslim is a good human being in the first place. You cannot be a good Muslim if you're not a good human being. In that good human being, I mean positive contribution, not just to yourself, your family, your faith system, your society, your country, but the world as a whole, not just humanity in it, but everything in it. That positive contribution makes you a better person. And being a better person is an essential element of being a good Muslim. It's not about the ritualistics and the appearances. Those are important. I'm not talking about the appearance and the looks. I'm talking about the ritual. The mechanics of worship are important, but the mechanics of worship are never the purpose, are never the objective. They're only means to the objective. Alright? Allah says that لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. All these things so you can achieve taqwa. What's the definition of taqwa? Al-Quran Kareem puts it straightforward. وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. So the Quran puts birr and taqwa. Birr means piety. Taqwa, let's say, because we translate it as fear of Allah, we translate other things anyway. Let's see what the Quran puts it. How does the Quran define it? Birr and taqwa versus ithm and udwan. Birr means piety, ithm means sin. Taqwa, let's say taqwa, versus udwan. Udwan means transgression. So if I was to take mafhum al-mukhalafa in the Quran, the definition of taqwa would be, do not transgress. That's what taqwa means. Do not transgress. Don't transgress what? Don't transgress on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rights, and don't transgress on people's rights. That's what taqwa is. So Martin Luther, they didn't listen to him. What do you mean reform? We like to keep it rituals. Obviously, you have, at that time in Europe, obviously, with any faith system, sometimes you develop an establishment or cult culture rather than a faith that's dynamic, that's made, or that is driving a transformation of people rather than just information of people. The whole point of faith is to drive the transformation of the human being from a selfish I, myself and I, or like Sigmund Freud would say, the id and the ego, but the id really, he means that, to drive that person from seeing only the self and the benefit of the self, and it's only me, to a person that sees that I beget happiness, and I derive happiness from giving happiness. The Islamic concept of giving is living. As long as you keep giving, you keep living. Giving is taking, actually. The more you give, the more you actually take. That's why Islam called charity, not charity, zakah. Zakah means what in the Arabic language? فَلَأَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَى. Zakah means increase, ziyadah, that's what zakah means. What do you mean? Giving charity 2.5% every year, at least. Giving, that's decrease, not increase. The Quran says you gotta grow. It's not decrease, it's increase. Why? Because giving is actually taking. That's why Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in al-Hasan, hadith is Hasan. So he encourages you to give. Those who have money, give money. Those who have ilm, give knowledge. Those who have time, give from your time. Those who have health, give, donate. That's something Allah gave you. Use it to serve other people. And then he tells you in this Hasan hadith, if you don't have anything to give, تبسمك في وجه أخيك صدقة. Then your mere smile in the face of your fellow human being is an act of charity. You have nothing to give, you can't give anything. So your mere smile, well, Hadith Hassan, if you don't have anything to give, you've got nothing to contribute. You don't have health, you don't have time, you don't have money, you don't have anything. Well, the least thing you can do is smile. That then counts as an act of charity. The point is you gotta give. As long as you live, you got to give. That's a fundamental Islamic principle. Surely, the cult culture in any faith system doesn't want to give, because cult is about me, not everyone else. Let them all go to heaven, who cares? Today, the cult culture is always busy with proving that others will go to hell rather than saving their own selves. So instead of improving myself and trying to make sure that I actually end up in heaven, I try to make myself feel better by locking everybody else in hell and closing the door. False sense of security for a very simple reason. In Islam we believe we are not equipped to judge other people's destinies. Let me repeat it. We are not capacitated. We as human beings are not equipped to judge other people's destinies. We're not even equipped to judge our own destiny, let alone other people. We can say the path that you're taking, we believe to be the wrong path. But I can't judge your destiny. Still, despite you taking the path, I can't judge your destiny. Get busy trying to secure your own rather than locking everybody else. Catholic Church in London, that was a fatal mistake a couple hundred years ago. So John Calvin came, and again, you're all aware of the Calvinist movement, and also an act of reform. And surely whenever you have reform, you're going to face the establishment and the cult culture. It ain't going to happen like they say. Excuse my slang. Then the Church of England came and also split. We're going to have our own rules. It's not working. It's all to try to save what's remaining of the faith, that became ritual rather than spiritually enriching people's lives and making them better people, per se. And that's why the end result, obviously, looking at our Christian brothers and sisters in humanity today, and again, I'm talking about back then, in that context, there was a serious detachment from the Catholic faith and the Catholic Church in Europe. That came to something that was known in the last century, secularism, right? That was the last century. The century is atheism. It's no longer secularism. You know what it's talking about, actually, the defiance to the idea or to the belief that actually we are a creation and there is a creator. And today the neo-atheism, you see Sam Harris, you see obviously starting with Nietzsche's Death of God, and obviously Sam Harris, the Richard Dawkins, the Hawkins, and all these things today. And we're still here, as obviously as, and these are, remember, these assaults are not only on Islam. No. These assaults are on the concept of God. Trying to say, obviously there's an ontological gap in the whole business in that, and from an epistemological, obviously, point of view, we can agree and give and take. I'm not going to go into this now. But it's just trying to say, since you cannot prove to me the existence of God through a mathematical formula or a physics formula, the lack of your ability to prove it through an epistemological limitation that I'm going to give you, it tells me somehow, so that's double jumping, it tells me that there's no God. So, I mean, you know, and that means it's not necessary, or if something is unnecessary, that means it doesn't exist. So, we're not going to go into the philosophical arguments of the whole thing, but remember again, that theory is coming to anti-God. Take people away, detach them from whatever they believe in, because the belief, no faith system on the face of the earth, regardless what that faith system is, tells you cheat, lie, steal. Be an evil person. Nobody tells you that. Regardless what you worship, all faith systems try to tell you be a good person, don't lie, don't cheat, don't steal, you know. All right, we have our ideological differences, but... So the focus on individualism has really sort of killed this spirit with the human beings lately. And obviously that's accentuated by faith systems dwarfing their faith into rituals rather than spiritual. So, since there are only, you know, a list of do's and list of don'ts. Do this, don't do this, that's it, you're done, go ahead. Rather than building the human character, building the human being. Sayyidina Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the first phase was the Mecca phase that lasted 13 years. Hadith al-Sahih, fi Sahih Bukhari, an Anas. في رواية عشر سنين رواية ابن عباس كان 15 والصحيح المجمع عليه is 13 years والرواية is also صحيحة وهذا عند العرب يعرف بجبر الكسر يعني العرب the Arabs round up numbers in the old days so they say 10 years when they mean 13 13 years Zakah was not yet enforced Hajj was not yet enforced many of the Sha'ai were not there. What was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doing in 13 years? Building character. He was building people like Abu Bakr, wa Umar, wa Uthman, wa Ali. Those people built the world. Today we build infrastructures to build people. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam built people and they built infrastructures. Building infrastructures is easy. Bricks can never build people, but people build up bricks. And what's missing today is the building of the human being as a character, as a full human being. Insan kamil, insan raqi, an elegant and an elevated and a spiritual human being that harbors no hate to his or her fellow human being, but wish them all the best in everything that they do. And this is the hadith of Al-Bukhari, عن أبي هريرة. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم says, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. One of you would not be a complete believer until you love for each other what you love for yourself. Each other, يعني for your fellow human being. No, no, he said you love, I mentioned that earlier. He said you would not be a believer in him until you love for your fellow human being what you love for yourself. Love for your fellow human being. Not just want, not just don't care, not just don't mind. Well, that distinguishes the men from the boys, or the claimers from the real. We can't afford to go into a cult culture. In today's world, where spirituality is void, and even the concept of God is being assaulted by every single one, and we're not even there. Yeah, in the old days, when the concept of Godhood was assaulted, we had people like Imam Ghazali, Abu Hamid, rahmatullahi alayhi. We had people like Al-Razi, we had people like Al-Amidi, we had people like Al-Maturidi, we had people like Al-Ash'ari, we had people who stood up, Imam Al-Haramain Al-Juwayni. We had people who could actually write and refute some erroneous philosophical ideas. تهافت الفلاسفة, تهافت التهافت, etc., etc., etc. Where philosophers went wrong. Today we're standing capable. Because we're still worried. You know, on focusing on secondary issues. And secondary issues, and making them the true test of faith, rather than the qat'iyat, the definitively transmitted issues in the deen, which are obviously in our faith system, in our religion, Islam, the qat'iyat, يعني الأمور القطعية, the definitive things are wide and merciful, you see, and they're encompassing and inclusive. But our own dhanniyat, our own non-definitive conclusions are not as merciful and inclusive. So, I got caught with Maulana Sayyid Aleem talking about the clash of civilization. Let me get out of this because I know you want me to talk about humanity. I'll just say a couple of words before I finish. But look, instead of talking about the clash of civilizations, and maybe this is somehow realized today, in a sense where there is a clash of civilization somehow. I believe in a dialogue between civilization or of civilization, like Edward Said and others who wrote about the dialogue of civilizations rather than the clash of civilizations. We can actually not only coexist, but we can contribute to each other, to each other's growth, and each other's perfection, per se. And hey, guidance, as we believe as Muslims, it comes from the Creator. It's not in my possession. All I can do is be the best human being possible, and guidance comes from the Creator. If it comes, great. If it doesn't come, it's not in my jurisdiction. فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ لَسْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِالْمُسَيْطِرِ. Remind, for you are a reminder. You're not subjugating them. وَقُلِ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ إِنَّا أَعْتَدْنَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ نَارًا. You provide, and like they say, you can take the horse to the water, but you can't make him drink. From your theological perspective, whether people believe what you believe or don't believe what you believe, regardless what it is, that should never have any impact on you being the best human being you can to them, regardless whether they believe in Islam or they don't believe in Islam. In other words, Islam believes in a concept called Ihsan. هَلْ جَزَاءُ, Allah says in the Quran, هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا Ihsan by definition means that you're good to those who are good to you and good to those who are not good to you. I always say, in other words, Islam is telling us, if you are good to those who are good to you, then what good are you? If you're good to those who are good to you, then what good are you? I mean, you're supposed, give me a break, you're supposed to be good to those who are good to you. That's minimum decency. What, you're supposed to be bad to those who are good to you? Ajib. Therefore, the mission statement of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by Allah, by no one else, no one wrote the mission statement, but Allah willed for it to be, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim wa ma arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil-muslimin, lil-mu'mineen, lil-alameen. We sent you, O Muhammad, but as an unconditional compassion to the creation. Not to the set of believers only. Who gave any cult or anybody the authority to limit and restrict Allah's mercy onto His creation? He sends His rain to those who believe in Him and sends His rain to those who don't believe. He sends His rain onto good people and sends His rain onto evil people who commit crimes. Are you going to stop the mercy of Allah from going onto His own creation? They are, you know, who's distributing? Let's go to dialogue. Sure, I'm not saying, you know, I don't like, the reason I'm saying this because while I do believe, obviously, there is some, sure, you know, today when you look, you know, again to what Mawlana Sayyid Ali Mashraf, hafidhahullah ta'ala, mentioned, when you look at the United Nations numbers today, the Muslims are the largest numbers of victims of wars in the world. When you examine the numbers from the United Nations, Muslims are the largest numbers of refugees in the world today. When you look at, again, the United Nations numbers, Muslims are the largest numbers of victims of violence in the world. Victims of violence in the world today. The irony in all that, I always say, is Muslims are seen as a disruption to an otherwise calm, peaceful, and content world. All right. We can sit here and blame the media and blame blah, 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 and blame everybody else. I like to look at it from a different perspective. Al-Quran always insisted, the Quran came with consolation, obviously. But consolation was not always easy or sweet or struggle-free or pain-free. For Al-Quran always insisted that you don't have to blame anybody else, you blame yourself. In other words, what I'm trying to say is, no one's gonna hand you a free microphone. The brothers here did a lot less than Mawlana Sayyid Alim is giving me a free microphone. We live in a world where no one's going to hand you a free microphone. You've got to earn it. Oh, that's not fair? Oh. Well, if you're looking for a perfect world, you need to wait till Jannah, till heavens. But we don't live in a perfect world, do we? So let's be real. So we don't have this delusion that we already live in the next world in heavens. We don't. We live on earth. And that means there is the good, the bad, and the ugly. And also amongst Muslims, there is the good, the bad, and the ugly. Absolutely. We're human beings like everybody else. Faith is something, and there are those who claim the faith is another. We strive to come close to the faith. But you know, there's all kinds of people. So, instead of shifting the blame, it's their mistake, it's their this, let's see the question. What are you going to do about this? How are you going to change it for the better? I'm not asking for a reaction. I'm asking for an action. What are you going to do? How are you going to make this world a better world? As Al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emphasizes in the Sunnah. And the Quran asks us, Allah says, استعمركم فيها. He asked you, استعمركم means, He asked you, يعني Allah, the Creator, and the Prophet ﷺ asked of us to leave the world better than when we entered the world. So question, that was your mission, that to leave this world, to positively contribute to this world, so that when you leave it, it's in a better shape, at least from your own efforts, than when you entered. So, where are you with that mission and those milestones, is the question. It's not about emotions. It's about actual deeds with proper intentions and selfless servitude. That's what it is about. It's about a reform that we start from within ourselves. That we start within ourselves. That we don't just talk about the mercy of Islam, but we internalize the mercy within us first. So we become fully merciful people and compassionate people within ourselves, onto our first circle, which is our family, and then maybe our society, our community, our society, our country, and then the world as a whole. We can't offer others mercy if we don't internalize mercy. People don't want to hear lip service about mercy and compassion and these things. People want to see mercy in action. They want to see an embodiment of compassion within you. They don't just want to see looks and you hand them out pamphlets. Reform is what's needed, in my view. Today, the violence that's happening in the world, and again, I'm stuck with this for whatever reason, my mind can't get off of this. The violence in the world today, violence is the language of the inarticulate. We understand that. Violence is the language of the inarticulate. And Nabiul Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith al-Bukhari, hadith is known. He says, jittu bi jawami'i al-kalim. I am, Allah gave me the most articulation. If Islam came with anything, it came with an absolute struggle, or I'm going to put it, quote unquote, war against all kinds of violence. Everything, verbal violence and physical violence. And other kinds of violence. Verbal violence, I will say, is much worse than actual violence. Because that's where actual violence stems from. Stems from verbal violence. Hate incitement is what I mean by verbal violence. That's why we need reform. Surely, Sayyid Ali, Hafidhahullah, was talking about the dictators. I think I understood. Don't blame my Urdu knowledge. I don't understand the language much. But sure, political tyranny is one of the reasons for extremism. When you deprive people of hope, they have nothing to live for. They'll go crazy, they'll do all kinds of things. That's why Islam came with three fundamental things: hope, growth, and opportunity for all. For all, hope, growth, opportunity for redemption, opportunity for everyone. But obviously with political tyranny, that's taken away. Remember, I always talk about an unholy matrimony. Zawajani or nikah. unholy matrimony between political tyranny and religious tyranny. There's an unholy matrimony, it's always there. Whether this zawaj has no talaq. There's no divorce, they don't believe in divorce. There's a serious problem with religious tyranny. Because you see, political tyranny may steal. Political tyranny may deprive. Political tyranny may do all kinds of dhulm and injustices. Political tyranny may even kill. Religious tyranny does all that in the name of God. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة. القرآن goes to say, which means, يا all humankind, all humanity, all of you, you were all created from one nafs, one soul. All of you. All of you. حديث الحاكم في المستدرك وصححه. كلكم لآدم. الحديث has weakness in the sanad, لكن يعني with the شواهد الصحيحة إن شاء الله صحيح لغيره. Let's say at this point, كلكم لآدم وآدم من تراب. All of you are from Adam. All of you humanity are from Adam, and Adam is from clay. What is that telling you? That's telling you when you walk out on the streets, whether you are in the United States of America, where I come from, or whether you are in India. Those people who are walking on the streets and their children, they are your brothers and they are you. This is your family. It doesn't matter what faith they believe in. You need to genuinely care about their well-being as part of being a good family member, answerable to your father, eventually Adam, and to your creator. If you have something in your hand that you don't like, in one of the fingers, you don't cut off your finger, do you? Work with it. Ya ayyuhan nas. What's the difference? Kullukum li Adam. Ya ayyuhan nas, inna khalaq, ittaqu rabbakum. Have taqwa of your Lord. شوف يا أيها الناس, you are all ناس, you are all creation, and you have one رب. اتقوا ربكم, you have one creator. And have تقوى. Notice we said تقوى what? Quranically defined. Do not transgress. That's what تقوى is. تقوى is not that you look like $1 million and your heart harbors hate. That's not تقوى. Taqwa is not that you look like a pious person, but you slander other people, and you transgress upon them, and you belittle them. That's not taqwa. Taqwa is when your tongue is as clean as your heart, which is as clean and transparent as your soul. Taqwa is purity, not impurity. You can't mask taqwa with cosmetic appearance on the outside. When you clean the inside automatically shines. But no matter how much you put cosmetics on the outside, all the lotion, motion, and commotion will not help at the end of the day. Will not help. Because we're all going. We have to face it. You are, my dear beloved brothers and sisters, in faith and or in humanity, for those of you who are not Muslims, you are standing on an assembly line that's moving and moving fast. You're going fast. Ask those who are 40 and 50 years old to tell you it was yesterday we were 20. Yesterday, it was literally yesterday, we were 20 years old. You're moving fast. If you realize this, that's one thing. Good for you. What are you doing about it if you realize it? If you don't realize it, that's double the trouble. You don't even realize that you're actually moving. We're all here to go. None of us is here to stay. All of us are going to go. All of us. And we all have to answer to the Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. What have you done? أَمَّاذَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ تَعْمَلُونَ عَفْوًا أَكَذَّبْتُمْ بِآيَاتِ وَلَمْ تُحِيطُوا بِهَا عِلْمًا أَمَّاذَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ What were you doing in the dunya, the Quran asks. What were you doing? What, busy building yourself? And thinking that by building yourself, this is your role in the world, this is your role as a creation, versus positive contribution to everything else, including yourself. Humanity starts from there, and therefore, notice when Islam talked about Nas as everybody, the hadith that the Honorable Shaykh, Allah bless him, brought from Sahih Imam Muslim about Daws, when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responded, Allahumma hadi Dawsan wa'ati bihim. Oh Allah, guide Daws and bring them. The other hadith, there's different riwayat. One, some of them are Hassan, some of them are Sahih. You all know them. Jabalul Malak, Malakul Jabal, Malakul Amtar, Malakul Matar. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to Al-Ta'if, 45 minutes away from Mecca. And you know what they did to Al-Ta'if. Obviously, you know, they slandered him, they terrorized him, they verbally abused him. You know the deal. Usual with any reformer, huh? Establishment has to stand against them. The religious establishment or the political establishment, it means the religious tyranny and the political tyranny, not necessarily establishment per se. Look at Pharaoh. When Musa alayhi salam came to Egypt, Musa came to Egypt, Pharaoh gathered, Pharaoh who said to the people, Ana rabbukum al-ala, I am your supreme Lord. This is now the new deen, new religion that Pharaoh is introducing. Forget your old Egyptian religion, believe in me, I'm your God. Alright. Now Musa comes to Egypt to call them to worship the Creator, not worship the creation. Pharaoh gathers all the people. What does he tell them? The Quran speaks on his behalf. Inni akhafu an yubaddila deenakum. Ajib. He says to them, I'm afraid that Musa will change your deen. Aw an yudhhira fil ardi al fasad. Or that Musa will cause fasad, corruption on earth. Now look who speaks now, who's wearing the jubba of the deen and speaking about the akhlaq. Pharaoh is saying, Pharaoh, the tyrant, the religious tyrant and the political tyrant and the one who woke up one day and wanted to kill all the people from the Israelites, huh? From Bani Israel, even the babies, kill them all. He just woke up on the wrong side of the bed, said, kill them, kill everybody. Huh? Now he says, I'm afraid that Musa will change your religion, you people of Egypt. I am trying to defend your religion. There you go, that's religious tyranny. You switch the whole thing. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to Al-Ta'if. They treated him the way they, you know, Quraysh and Bani Thaqif, Al-Ta'if, they told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam this, all these things, etc. Would they hurt him? His honorable feet are bleeding, etc. All these things. Adas from Inawa comes to him. Huh? All you know this. I'm not going to go through the story because I want to finish. I know I'm out of time. Okay, let me just give me 10 minutes on that. The riwaya, al-Tabarani, others mentioned, when hadith sahih, la yanzil an hasan, from a sanad point of view. Jibreel comes to him and says, Ya Rasulullah, with me is Malak. Lam yanzil. He did not come to any prophet before you. I have an angel with me asking, yasta'din. He's asking permission to speak to you. He has never come to any human being before you. وفي رواية ملك الجبال ورواية ملك الأمطار. ملك المطر is رواية صح. More authentic. He tells them basically, Ya Rasulullah, allow me to take these mountains and just crush them on these people who don't see, you know, don't realize who you are and all these things. crush mountains on human beings? What was the hadith that for Sahih, for Bukhari, Muslim, all these things? What would the Prophet ﷺ used to make dua? Allahumma ahdi qawmi fa innahum la ya'lamun. Oh Allah, guide my people, for they do not know. Guide them. Allah did not send, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not send the prophets with weapons of mass destruction. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give the prophets weapons of mass destruction with the command, anyone who doesn't believe in you, press the button, vaporize him. Smoke him, that's it, done. You don't believe, you're out. We don't have that. Allah did not send them the prophets with weapons of mass destruction. He sent them with weapons of mass construction. Mass instruction. Not destruction. Destruction is easy. But construction is difficult and challenging. That's why we are the children of Adam, not the children of Shayateen. Yes or no?
Yes.
Adam is made from what?
Clay.
Shaitan made from what?
Fire.
What's the difference between clay and fire? Fire destroys everything. Clay builds everything. That's the thing Shaitan couldn't understand. Shaitan was arguing with Allah, أَنَا قَلَ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِنْ I am better than him. خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارُ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ طِينَ You created me from fire and you created him from clay. And to Shaitan, Iblis's mind, fire is better than clay. Where is in the Quran where Allah is telling Shaitan who is afdal, who is better? The command was not who is better amongst you. The command was do sujood. Why do you divert the question anyway? Number two, who told you, ya Iblis, that fire is better than clay? It says who? You? I mean, who tells you who's better? Humanity, sure. I mean, you know, I'm not going to sit here and paint a pink picture of things. No. From Adam alayhi salam, our father, the father of all humanity, we always had this line. The line that was pro-fasad and bloodshed and corruption, and the line that was pro-construction. Habil, Cain, the son of Adam, killed his own brother, Habil, Abel. Habil, the very son of Adam, فَسَوَّلَتْ لَهُ نَفْسُهُ أَتْلَخِي He killed Cain, or Qabil, killed his own brother. With hadith Sahih, where Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, not anyone that does a killing of one soul, إِلَّا عَلَى ابْنِ آدَمِ الْأَوَّلْ كِفْلٌ He buries one, you know, buries the brand also. But here's the question. I'm not saying there are people who are descendants of Cain, so that desire of killing and violence and bloodshed is inherited in them. Many of the scholars say that the offspring of Cain, Qabil, was off. But whether it was or wasn't, didn't the Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to change? Aren't we supposed to be better? Isn't that the purpose of life? That you always try to be a better human being? And that means you need to question your worship if your acts of worship are not making you a better human being. There's a problem with your worship mechanically, or there's a problem with your worship from a faith fundamentally. Because it's not making you a better person. There's a problem. If you are making salah and you're making prayers and the prayer is not making you a better person,
you need to question either that you're not doing the prayer correctly or your iman is fundamentally flawed. Because Allah tells us in the Quran, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. As-salah prevents you from doing evil, from saying evil, from committing evil. So how come you just do the prayer and then you go and slander other people and do ghiba of other people and do namima on other people? There's a problem either with your salah or with your very iman. There's no two ways about this. It's not about the looks. It's not about the words. I always say, especially we as Muslims, we have mastered the art of articulation and speeches. When talking the talk comes, oh. But when walking the walk comes, it's about walking the walk, not just talking the talk. That's what separated us from the Sahaba. May Allah be well pleased with all us, every single one of them. They not just talked the talk, but they walked the walk. That's why Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لِمَ تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. Why you say that which you do not do? Why? The meaning of the ayah. That's why I say bravery is not really saying what you believe. Lots of people say what they believe. Today people play, I call it mental tennis, what they believe. What does that mean? I believe in this, what do you believe in? Oh no, I don't believe in this, I think it's this way. No, I think it's this way, so now we kill each other. Bravery is not saying what you believe. Bravery is believing what you say. Really believing what you say. Love is not a word. We say our religion is the religion of love, which is true. This is the fundamental aspect of our faith, love. Love of Allah, love of His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, love of the awliya, love of the sahaba, love of the tabi'een, love of Ahlul Bayt, love of doing good, love. But love is not a word. Love is a amal and a hal. It's an action and a state. It's not a motto, a slogan. Slogans, you can't catch them anywhere. It's an actual deed. It's an actual trust. When it came to humanity, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allahumma hadi qawmi fa innahum, like, oh Allah, guide them. They don't know. That's why in Sahih Imam Muslim, the hadith is Sahih, huh? So I'm not bringing you from my pocket, no story. Janaza comes before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Janaza, funeral of a dead person. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stands up. He was sitting, Sayyidul Khalq, Imamul Anbiya wal Mursaleen, stands up. When the janazah is coming, the funeral is coming, he stands up. قَالُوا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ يَهُودِي وَرِوَايَ إِنَّهُ ذِمِّي. يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, he is ذِمِّي. يعني he is not Muslim. And in another way, he is a Jew. He's a Jewish person. Or he is not a Muslim. You, the Prophet of Allah, you're standing up. He may have thought he's a Muslim, you're standing up. And Nabi, you know what the Prophet's response was? أَوَلَيْسَتْ نَفْسًا? Isn't this a soul? Isn't this a human being, a soul? The right of neighborhood. Hadith Sayyid Aisha radiallahu anha, hadith has weakness. يعني في ضعف في السند. لكن حسن البصري وأدرس قتادة mentioned it. ويعني even though these things are fadail, but anyway. When she said, what is the limit of your neighbor? سيدة عائشة الصديقة رضي الله تعالى عنها وأرضاها بنت الصديق رضوان الله عليهم أجمعين. She said 40 neighbors to this direction, 40 neighbors to that direction, 40 neighbors, 40 neighbors in this direction, 40 neighbors in that direction. 40 neighbors. How many of you know your 40th neighbor? Just in one direction. Not like our mother, Aisha radiallahu anha, said, in all directions. You see why we have, there's a problem with our rituals, that what we made our deen rituals rather than actual spiritual practice? But that's the essence of, again, of Islam, that neighbor of yours. You all know the story that's mentioned in the books about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam cleaning before his door. Though it has no authentic sanad, but anyway, it's a good story. Humanity is to do what? Istamarakum. He asked you to positively contribute. Not just humanity as far as being good to your neighbor. No, Islam asked you, Islam by default affords every human being, regardless of his background or creed, dignity. Dignity. Where is the dalil? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. We have honored, Allah tells us the meaning of, we gave takreem, we honored the children of Adam. Khalas, you're honored. Just because you are the child of Adam, you're a human being, Islam afforded you dignity and respect and worth, regardless of your creed or background or caste or whatever it is that you are. It's not just about the human beings. It's about the universe that we live in, or the, you know, the multiverse. Multiverse, what do you mean the universe? I mean, it's another time. You remember the riwayat fi Muslim and Bukhari both. One riwayat on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, where he says that a woman دخلت امرأة النار في قطة. A woman was punished for punishing a cat, not a human being, inflicting harm on a cat. That woman was subject to punishment. Notice, a cat, animal rights, not just human rights. No, no. And the other hadith also, about the man who was thirsty, the Bedouin who was thirsty in the desert, and he saw a thirsty dog, he went deep down to the well of water and brought that thirsty dog a drink. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, Allah forgave that man all of his sins because he gave a thirsty dog a drink. We're not talking human beings here. Look at the equality of Islam when one looks at the human being. Salah. We stand in one line, we pray, right? It doesn't matter where you come from. It doesn't matter what your color is. Doesn't matter what titles you have before, after, and in the middle of your name. Because today we have this, you know, this sort of appetite for more, because this thing, you know, instead of having a content, we can do cosmetics, because everything is about makeup today. It doesn't matter what your titles are. I don't care how many PhDs you have. I remember when we received our PhD, that our teachers were telling us, congratulations, now you are a student. What? After all this, now you're telling me, I thought that I'm the man. Congratulations, now you have the keys to be a student of knowledge. Shukran. Jazakumullah khair. Doesn't matter who you are, doesn't matter how much money you have, doesn't matter where you come from, doesn't matter whether you're black, white, whatever in between, you stand in the same line of prayers before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're all equal. You're all the same. When you go to pilgrimage, to Mecca, to Hajj, we all wear the same thing, huh? You wear these towels around you. I don't know how many rupees here they cost in India, but whatever it is, you can't wear polo towels. Maybe now they'll make them, huh?
Because Giorgio Armani towels. Maybe we'll have Rolex towels one day. But they're all the same. I don't care what it says here. You can't have it sewed. It has to be plain. You're all the same. You're all the same. And when we all pass from this plane, from this earth, earth has a funny way of equalizing all the equations above it. You see, on top of the earth, we act all mighty and powerful and different. We distinguish ourselves, whether by, well, intrinsically the human being wants to be distinguished. And there's nothing wrong with that. As long as what distinguishes you is your positive contribution to self and others. Not just because you dress a certain way, or your name is a certain way, or you have a certain title. That's what Islam teaches. But Earth, let me finish with this, has a funny way of equalizing the inequalities above it. Regardless who you are, once you're buried, I don't care what they put on top of the Earth, but below it, you're all the same. You're all the same. Al-Ma'arri, Al-Ma'arri is one of the poets in the old days, hundreds of years ago in Syria, from Ma'arrat al-Nu'man, which is a small city between Halab and Hama, where Mawlana Sayyid Alim is originally from. Hama is about 70 kilometers from the city of Halab, and Ma'arrat is in between, right there in the middle. And from it came a very famous philosopher and poet called Al-Ma'arri. Al-Ma'arri, anyway, I'm not going to go and talk about his philosophy because that's another time. It'll take us 3 hours to go through it. And I'm not going to keep you here except for 5 more minutes, trust me. I promise. You know, that's the problem with Mawlana's. Once you give them the microphone, they don't want to let go. Let me have it. Can I take it home? We got to learn to give chance to others, don't we? That's right. That's what life is. Anyway. Al-Ma'arri, he went out hundreds of years ago, he looked at the graveyard. You call it here Qabristan, right?
Yes.
So he looked at, I'm learning some more new words, huh? Takes me a couple of times and then I'll catch up a little bit. Anyway, he looked at the graveyard before him. He saw graveyards, graves of people. He asked himself, he says, هَذِي قُبُورُنَا تَمْلَأُ الْأَرْضُ فَأَيْنَ الْقُبُورُ مِنْ عَهْدِ عَادِ. He says, these are our graves, the grave of my tribe, my people. What happened to the graves of people of Aad and Thamud, وَقَوْمْ تُبَّعْ, those people who lived thousands and thousands of years ago, where are their graves? How come I don't see their graves? All I see is graves that extend maybe 100, 200, 300 years. What happened to the graves of people who lived 3, 4, 5,000 years ago? Where are their graves? هَذِي قُبُورُنَا تَمْلَأُ الْأَرْضُ فَأَيْنَ الْقُبُورُ مِنْ عَهْدِ عَهْدِ. Where are the qubur from Aad? He says, خفف الوطأ ما استطعت. He says, when you walk, then he looked at them, he looked at the graves, then he smiled, he says, رُبَّ لَحْدٍ صَارَ لَحْدًا مِرَارًا ضَاحِكًا مِنْ تَزَاحُمِ الْأَطَّادِ. He says, it seems that those graves that we have, they already know the recycling game long time ago. Thousands of years ago, you buried a sultan here, a rich man, a high, mighty man in this grave. After a few thousand years, it's gone. Now we made a new grave. We didn't even know that there was a grave here before for an important person. But now you put a slave there in that same grave. And he says that qabr, or that grave itself, is laughing
Because 1,000 years ago it housed a sultan, and after 1,000 years now it's housing a slave. Ajib, how that earth has a way of recycling and equalizing. Well, your mother earth eventually swallows you. You grow, you are anyway clay, then earth feeds you, gives you milk. How do you get milk? You get milk, or you get other things from goats or other things or so, and they eat the grass, so they're eating, earth is feeding them, and then it gives you vegetables, earth gives you fruits, gives you food, makes you really good and big and fat, which is not good. And then, once you're ready to go, it swallows you back in. It disintegrates you entirely to minute things again, and the recycling goes and goes and goes. So that's why Al-Ma'arri says, سر إن استعت في الهواء رويدا لا اختيالا على رفات العباد. When you walk on earth now, he says, when you walk on the sand on earth, he said, سَلْ إِنِ اسْطَعْتَ, if you can, walk on air. Don't try to make your feet step on the sand when you walk. As if you're almost flying, don't put your weight on the sand. فِي الْهَوَاءِ رُوَيْدًا لَا اخْتِيَالًا عَلَى رُفَاتِ الْعِبَادِ. Don't walk with heavy feet and your weight on these particles of sand that used to be part of some people who used to be honorable in the old days. خَفِّفِ الْوَطْأَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتِ فَمَا أَظُنُّ أَدِيمَ الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا مِنْ هَذِهِ الْأَجْسَادِ. Walk with ease, for this sands that you're stepping on were parts of people that used to live. That could have been خَدٌّ لِكَاعِدِ الْحَسْنَانِ. Another poetry says, this could have been what you're stepping on, could have been a remnant of a cheek of a beautiful woman one day. What happened? Death folded their dreams and took away their plans and snatched their ambition. We're all going there. All of us are going there. And we will have to answer to one thing. What have you done? What have you done? Oh, you dressed a certain way? Oh, you had a certain title? What did you do with what we gave you? With the time we gave you, with the health we gave you, with the wealth we gave you, with the ilm, with the knowledge we gave you, all these things we gave you. كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. Hadith صحيح. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم says, every one of you is responsible. What have you done? Humanity, my dear beloved brothers and sisters, come from us first. I'm not going to sit here and blame X, Y, and Z for things that happen. Hey, I don't believe that we live in a perfect world either. I don't live in a fantasy, world of fantasia or a fantasy world. No, this is real. We got the good, the bad, and ugly everywhere. But that's something I cannot change. You cannot change people around you, but you can change the people you are around. You can change yourself. That's why the Quran puts it at a fundamental phase. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah does not change the state of people until they change themselves first. If you want to see a change, you be that change. You change yourself. You take the Quran and the Sahih of the Sunnah to heart, not just lip service. That's where humanity starts. If we want to actually go back to the standards of humanity of Islam, which is one of the finest, it is, in my view, is the finest bill of human rights and animal rights and plant rights and everything else rights. First, we have to change ourselves. We have to internalize those values, and then you'll see the world changing around you. We have to infuse love in this universe little by little, as much as we can. We have a mandate as Muslims to leave this world better than when we entered this world. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a wish always for a better world, and we have a long way to go to build bridges and to brighten our world in so many ways that we can. And this is not just a privilege, it's a responsibility. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa alayhi wa sallam.
Takeaway for me personally, and I believe all my brothers and sisters also have got a lot of takeaway from the speech of the Sheikh. Now it's turn for the question and answer session. Brothers and sisters, there are mics with the volunteers out there. So if you have got any question to ask the Sheikh, you can just raise your hand and reach the microphone and ask the question. It's up to the Sheikh's discretion to answer the question. I request all of you to limit your question to the topic of the day, that is Islam and humanity. However, if the Sheikh wants to entertain any question of yours which is out of the circle, then also it's all right.
You said that we have to reform ourselves before we are going to reform others. We have to think good about ourselves. We have to make ourselves good before we are going to do something good for others. So my question is, like before we do that, what we have to do when we meet people like, we have people like Khawarij today exist. We have people like Yazid ibn Muawiyah today exist. We have people like Abu Jahl today exist. What we should do when we interact with people like this?
It's not about what they do. Is what will you do? Do you respond on the same level, or you generate a reflection of your high values and your reforming manner? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was slandered. He never slandered back, did he? Was hurt. He did not hurt them back. He prayed for them. So, there are many ways that we can do things. That evil is a fact of life. We can't unfortunately change that. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala capacitated the human being of the ability to do things. So we do wrong things as well as right things. So I think the question is, what do we do? And that me and you have to come up and look at the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and try to see how we can always maintain a behavior that's consistent with the sunnah. What would the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do is the question for me. That's how I would start answering the question. What would he do if he was here today? No. And I remember that when he went to Mecca sallallahu alaihi wasallam fi fatih Mecca, in the liberation of Mecca, and you know, some of those people were thugs and criminals and you name it. Right? Criminals. He came to Mecca, what did he say? اذهبوا فأنتم طلقاء. Go, you are forbidden, you are free. You are pardoned. من دخل دار أبي سفيان فهو آمن. من دخل داره فهو آمن. من دخل المسجد الحرام فهو آمن. Whoever enters his home is safe. Whoever enters the house of Abu Sufyan is safe. Whoever enters the Haram is safe. Islam did not come to, if people do evil, we don't repel evil with evil. But I'm trying to say, hate cannot extinguish hate. Love extinguishes hate. And that doesn't mean that you turn your other cheek. I'm not telling you that. What I'm saying is a prophetic way of wise, non-violent, is a weapon that knows no defeat.
My request is that the reformation, what you have stated, is absolutely right, I agree. But the source should be the Quran, the micro and the macro laws of the Quran. That is where we have to start again. The micro as well as the macro laws of the Holy Quran. From there, every Muslim has to begin. So my humble request to you is to kindly keep it this in view, future lectures, so that the people will have a better understanding of the law of Islam.
You have any questions? Yeah,
yeah. I mean, terrorism, Latin Muslims today, we live one of the most extreme and polarized times. What I'd like to know is that within Ahl al-Sunnah, there's a growing anathematization. We start accusing others within our own sex. How do we counter that?
I understand the concept that's very, very important. Unity does not mean conformity. Unity does not mean conformity. In other words, if we learn from the Sahaba anything, we learn that we can look at one thing and see it in two different ways. In other words, if I ask you, what am I holding in my hand? I ask you to describe it. You'll describe a bottle of water from your perspective. If I ask the brother behind me, what am I holding in my hand, he'll describe that same bottle of water from a different angle. But you're both talking about the bottle.
No.
Having said that, that means at least the bottle, that example, the metaphor, we ought to agree on the book and the sahih of the sunnah, kitab wa sunnah. That must be the basis. And then, issues, how we see, if they're not qat'i, then in non-definitive issues, we may disagree, and in that disagreement, unity should not be conformity. That's all. Did not discriminate against women. Islam actually gave women all the rights of any other human being. So you have the right to learn Islam and learn anything else and be as good as you can be. That's all. We have many of the shuyukh, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, I believe, rahimahullah ta'ala, amongst the ijaz al-hadith, many female scholars and other ulama as well. So yeah, there's, the sky is the beginning, not the limit.
From Atlanta. Just before we conclude, I just wanted to share that the Sheikh has released his book, Expressing the Light and the Birth of the Light. It has, it's a very comprehensive work and one of the greatest works written on celebrating the birth of the Holy Prophet in the history of Islam. So I would urge everybody who can get a copy of this, you get one for yourself. Read it thoroughly, understand it. It has many answers to questions from bid'ah, the definition of bid'ah, to the celebration of the Prophet in light of the Quran and Hadith. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a tawfiq to get a copy of this, read it. It should be in all the Muslim homes, so do try to get one of these as you can. And we again like to thank all the organizers for arranging all the events, inshallah, and we look forward to seeing you further.
There are a couple of announcements to be made. This book and a DVD of the Sheikh is on sale.
حضرت گرامی آپ سے گزارش ہے کہ آپ سب اپنی جگہ پر بیٹھے رہیں ابھی آپ کو چند منٹ کے لیے صدارتی کلمات بھی آپ کو سماعت کرنے ہیں قبل کل شیء اريد ان اتوجه بالشكر الجزيل الى فضيلة الشيخ السيد الشريف محمد بن يحيى النينوي حفظه الله على هذه الكلمة الطيبة والتوجيهات الصديقة والنصائح القيمة بارك الله في عمره وفي أعماله ووفق الله لما يحبه ويرضاه من صالح العمل وآخر میں میں شیخ الجامعہ جامعہ نظامیہ سے گزارش کروں گا کہ وہ مختصر سی مگر صدارتی کلمات کے لیے تشریف لائیں اور مختصر میں سلامت صدارتی کلمات اور اس کے بعد ہی حضرت دعا فرمائیں گے.
السلام علیکم ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ. الحمد للہ رب العالمین والصلاۃ والسلام علی سید الانبیاء والمرسلین وعلی آلہ الطیبین الطاہرین واصحابہ الاکرمین اجمعین. اما یا ذات شرف انا العالم العارف لغة الانجليزية غلط القيت كلمة الحامة في لغة الانجليزية لكن مع ذلك افهم ما تريد. هذا من كراماتي.
كراماتكم
لا من كراماتكم. بزرقوا نرحب بكم وكل منا سرينا بقدرة الله بلدنا هذا ونتمنى ونرجو منكم الزيارة متكررة ان شاء الله. بزرقوا دوستو آپ نے ابھی فضیلت الشیخ سے زبان انگریزی اسلام قرآن حدیث سے متعلق اور ان کے دلائل کے ساتھ اسلام کی حقانیت اور صداقت اور اسلام کی عمل پسندی پر سیر حاصل خطاب سماعت فرمایا. اور یہ چونکہ یورپ اور عرب اور دیگر تمام علاقوں کا دورہ کرتے رہے ہیں اور وہاں کے حالات کا بذات مشاہدہ کیے ہیں اس لیے آپ کو وہاں کے تمام حقائق کا قطعی اور یقینی علم ہے. اسی بنا پر آپ نے یہ ساری تفصیلات بیان کی اور جو استفادے کا موقع ہم کو یہاں ان بزرگوں کی ذات مولانا سے اچھا جیسی صاحب اور ان کے رفقا کی جانب سے فراہم کیا گیا میں ان کا بھی شکریہ ادا کرتا ہوں اور آپ سب کا شکریہ ادا کر کے دعا کرتا ہوں کہ اللہ ایسے مواقع ہم کو بار بار عطا فرمائے اور ہمارے لیے کام کی راہیں آہستہ ہی صحیح لیکن آئندہ کھلتی جائیں. سب اللہ تعالیٰ داخل خلق ہی وہ نور عرش واشخابی.
سلام و سلام کے لیے خیر.
Yeah.
JazakAllah. I thank the Shaykh, all of you, for attending this session. There are a couple of announcements to be made. There are two more programs of Shaykh coming up tomorrow. 15th December, after Zuhr at 1:30, and Masjid Al-Aqsa. Masjid Rahmat Alam, the topic of the talk is Masjid Al-Aqsa in Quran and Hadith. The time of the program is 1:30 after Zuhr at Masjid Rahmat Alam. Tomorrow itself, after 6:30 p.m., there is a talk on the Shaykh on the topic role of Muslim youth at Sufi Masjid Balamrai Hinga, Paradise, Secunderabad. We request you to be present on these two occasions to benefit by the